Okay, so this week we're going to be talking about gymnosperms, also known as the naked seed plants. I'm actually really biased towards gymnosperms because I study two native pine species in California for my thesis. So I love gymnosperms. I think they're awesome. I think other groups of plants are awesome as well, but I just love gymnosperms even more. But just a quick review of basal land plants, which is what you guys have been talking about for the past 2 weeks. So the basal land plants include the non-vascular land plants as well as the seedless vascular land plants. So seedless vascular would have been the Lycopodiophyta and the Manilophyta, and then the non-vascular land plants would have been your liverworts and mosses. But for those two groups, they all together make up the basal land plants. And the way that they essentially dispersed or completed their life cycle was through spores. So the spores were basically dormant until they landed in some kind of body of water, or if they were in a really moist and wet environment that allowed them to germinate and produce a brand new gametophyte. So essentially a brand new plant. And with this, how this would happen is essentially the gametangia, which for the basal land plants would be the archegonia, which is the female reproductive structure, and the antheridia, which is the male reproductive structure, those two would produce gametes. So the archegonia would produce the egg, antheridia would produce the sperm. They'd come together, they would undergo fertilization, and then produce a diploid embryo. And then that diploid embryo would undergo meiosis. It would produce a new diploid sporophyte. And then that diploid sporophyte would undergo meiosis and produce the haploid spores. In the case of, for example, mosses, those spores would be held in some kind of sporangium. If we're talking about leptosporangiate ferns, those would be housed on the sori. If you're thinking of Selaginella or lycopods, that's where the sporangia would then be housed on the strobili. But essentially, the spores are produced, and then once the spore lands in some kind of water, when they get dispersed, then they'll undergo mitosis and produce a brand new gametophyte. So for spores, they once again, they required water and some moist habitat in order to produce a brand new free-living gametophyte. So if we think back to millions and millions of years ago, this is what it was kind of expected that it looked like with this large body of water. It looks like we have some mosses here, maybe some liverworts. This is another picture of what it possibly looked like during the Ordovician. We have some small bodies of water here, and then some of the smaller basal land plants. It looks like we might have some seedless vascular plants, such as lycopods or Selaginella, maybe. As you can see, basal land plants really were not that big compared to the plants that you're probably used to seeing today, like gymnosperms and angiosperms. There were some members of the Lycopodiophyta that did get really, really big and tall, like Lepidodendron, but we didn't talk about that with you guys because that specific group within the Lycopodiophyta are extinct now. So there were some members within the basal land plants that got pretty big, but for the most part, they were pretty small and low to the ground, which is why gymnosperms and angiosperms today were essentially able to outcompete them. Okay, so then if we look at this phylogenetic tree right here, we have all of our basal land plants on the far left, and the reason why they're on the far left is because they're the more basal group, so they essentially evolved earlier. And then over here to the right, we have our more derived groups, which are the gymnosperms, which are these guys right here. These are what we're going to be focusing on today. And then the angiosperms, which are the flowering plants. So that's the more derived group. So again, starting from the far left, we have Hepatophyta. These are also known as the liverworts. Now, the phylum name that you guys learned was Marchantiophyta. So if you see Marchantiophyta or Hepatophyta, it's referring to the same group. They're both referring to the liverworts. It's just we don't use the term Hepatophyta anymore. We now use the term Marchantiophyta, but it's referring to the same exact group. And then we have the Bryophyta, which are the mosses. So these two groups make up the non-vascular land plants. And then we have the seedless vascular plants right here. So we have the Lycopodiophyta. And remember that this phylum includes the lycopods and Selaginella. And then we have the Pteridophyta right here. Another term for this that you guys are probably heard is Manilophyta. So that includes the leptosporangiate ferns, whisk ferns, horsetails, etc. This is just the old name, but now we call them the Manilophyta. But Pteridophyta, Manilophyta, same group. In between the evolution of basal land plants and the seed plants, which includes the gymnosperms and the angiosperms, there were four really important characteristics that essentially allowed these groups to proliferate and inhabit more drier areas and essentially outcompete these basal land plants. And these four characteristics are the seeds and the pollen. So with the evolution of seeds and pollen, it essentially made the spores kind of obsolete. I mean, spores are still essential for the life cycle to be completed, but it's no longer, the spores are no longer the reproductive structure that's being dispersed. It is now the seeds and the pollen. And this evolved around the same time. And then we also have the evolution of secondary xylem and phloem. So keep in mind that seedless vascular plants do have true vascular tissues. They do have a xylem and phloem, but it's not secondary xylem and phloem. It's really just primary xylem. So they don't have any true wood or true bark yet. But gymnosperms and angiosperms do. And then finally, the last characteristic is the gametophyte being housed on the sporophyte. So keep in mind that with the basal land plants, well, actually really for the non-vascular plants, they were gametophyte dominant, and the sporophyte completely relied on the gametophyte throughout its entire life cycle. Whereas with the seedless vascular plants, if you think back to last week, these guys are sporophyte dominant, but the sporophyte still relies on the gametophyte during its early stages. Now, as we're transitioning into seed plants today, where today we're going to be talking about gymnosperms, they are sporophyte dominant and the gametophyte is much more reduced. It's a lot less complex and it completely relies on the sporophyte now for water, nutrients, etc. So essentially, as the plants get more and more derived, the gametophyte gets smaller and smaller, it gets much more reduced, and the sporophyte becomes more dominant. Does that make sense? Okay. So feel free to unmute yourselves at any time. Again, if you have a question, or if you want to go ahead and type a question in the chat, go ahead and do that as well. Okay. So again, the group that we're going to be focusing on today are the gymnosperms, also known as the naked seed plants, and we're going to be looking at the three extant or living phyla, which is the Cycadophyta, Gynecophyta, and the Coniferophyta. Okay, so gymnosperms are a monophyletic group. So this includes the ancestor or their common ancestor and all of their descendants. And there were four developments in evolution that essentially allowed them to become successful and outcompete the basal land plants. So I just went over these four characteristics in the last slide, but I'm going to go ahead and go over it again really quickly. One of them is the gametophyte being housed on the sporophyte. So remember that these plants are now sporophyte dominant. And then we also have the evolution of the seed and pollen. These two, once again, happened at around the same time. And then also the evolution of secondary xylem and phloem. So they now have true wood and true bark. So the reason why gymnosperms are referred to as naked seed plants is because essentially their seeds are exposed. They don't have any fleshy sporophyte tissue surrounding them. So when you think of a fruit, the sporophyte tissue, the fleshy part that's surrounding the seed, is essentially the part that you guys will typically eat. And gymnosperms do not have that. Their seeds are essentially completely exposed. The only thing that's kind of protecting them is the cone or the strobili that they're in. But again, they don't have any tissue surrounding it. So again, that's why they're called the naked seed plants. So all gymnosperms evolved from heterosporous plant ancestors. So heterosporous meaning that they produce two distinct spore types, one female spore and one male spore, whereas a lot of the basal land plants were homosporous, meaning that they had one plant with both the female and the male spores on the same structure. So again, they had megaspores and microspores. So anytime you see the prefix mega, that is just referring to the female. And if you see the prefix micro, that is referring to the male. So anytime you see mega, whether it's megaspore, megasporangia cone, mega gametophyte, it's just talking about the female specifically. Or if it's microspore or microgametophyte, it's referring to the male. They also evolved from ancestors that had secondary tissues. So again, that's secondary xylem and phloem. And these, the evolution of these secondary tissues, these secondary vascular tissues, allowed the plants to resist bending. They were able to grow a lot taller. Because they were able to grow a lot taller, they were able to compete for light a lot better, which means they were able to grow taller. They can live a lot longer. And if they can grow taller, they can also disperse their seeds a lot farther away, increasing their chances of reproduction, essentially. Okay, So like I said, with gymnosperms, they are sporophyte dominant. So the gametophyte becomes completely reduced and it's housed on the sporophyte. But typically the gametophyte is going to be housed inside the strobili or inside the cones. So because they are sporophyte dominant, or you can think of it as diploid dominant, they now have two copies of the genome. So they're a lot more complex compared to the basal land plants that were gametophyte dominant. So this also allowed the plants to survive in a lot drier conditions. And again, that's because they no longer need, or at least the spores no longer need water in order for that life cycle to be continued and completed. So no longer need water for transport of gametes, or the establishment of the gametophytes, which again, that's the archegonia and the antheridia. And because they no longer depend on water, they can disperse inland and live in higher elevations as well. But not just higher elevations, they're able to live in drier, more arid environments because of this. Any questions so far? We're good? Okay. Okay, so now I'm specifically going to go over the male cone, the anatomy of the male cone. So just keep in mind that anytime you see the prefix micro, that is just referring to the male, and then the prefix mega is referring to the female. So right here in this image on the right, we have the male strobili, also known as the microsporangiate cones. So within the, you can think of a cone as essentially a conglomeration of tons of microsporophylls, which are essentially modified leaves. So anytime you see this word phyll as well, you can automatically think leaf, just like how phyllotaxy means leaf arrangement, megaphyll means large leaf, microphyll, small leaf, sporophyll just basically means a modified leaf as well, but that modified leaf houses the sporangia. But in this case, since we're specifically looking at a male cone, we refer to that as the microsporangia. So the microsporophylls, which in this picture of the anatomy right here, are basically the scales of the cone. So that's dyed purple here. So if you follow my cursor, for example, this is a microsporophyll, here's another microsporophyll, there's one microsporophyll here and here, so on and so forth. They're essentially the scales of the cone. And each microsporophyll houses a microsporangia. And so that's these sac-like structures right here that this bracket is on. So this is one microsporangia, another microsporangia, another microsporangia, so on and so forth. So the microsporangia are housed on those modified leaves, on those modified microsporophylls. Inside the microsporangia, that is where meiosis is going to take place. So that is where the male haploid microspores are going to be housed. And then eventually those haploid microspores are going to germinate and become a pollen grain, basically your male gametophyte. So once again, microsporophylls are the scales of the cone. The microsporophyll is going to house the microsporangia, which is this sac-like structure that my cursor is going around. Inside the microsporangia is where meiosis happens, and that's where you'll find the individual haploid microspores. And then eventually, that's what those little blue dots are inside the microsporangia. And then eventually, those haploid microspores will become the pollen grains, also known as your male gametophyte. So then if you zoom in on this image right there, here in this bracket is the microsporophyll. Once again, that's just the scale. And then this entire sac-like structure is the microsporangia. So again, that is where meiosis takes place and where the microspores are going to be housed. So each of these like individual circles is one haploid microspore. So there's tons of them within one microsporangia. And then eventually those microspores will germinate and become the pollen grains, also known as the male gametophyte, basically. So as you can see, there's tons of those within one microsporangia. So this is one microsporangia, and then there's another microsporangia. Does this anatomy make sense for the male cone? Okay. Okay, so like I said, those haploid microspores are eventually going to germinate and become your male gametophyte, also known as your pollen grain. So inside the pollen grain, there are two different cell types. You have your generative cell, which will produce your two sperm, so your two male gametes. And then you also have your tube cell, which will generate the pollen tube. And I'll talk about the importance of the pollen tube in a second. But with the pollen grain, it essentially provides protection for the male gametes, so protection for the sperm. And because of this, because most of the time the pollen grain is going to be dispersed in the wind, once again, no water was no longer necessary in order for the pollen grain to be dispersed and complete the life cycle. Okay, so once again, within the pollen grain, you have two cell types. You have your tube cell and your generative cell. And your tube cell is the one that's going to produce your pollen tube. And your generative cell is the one that's going to produce the two sperm. And the tube cell that produces the pollen tube is really important in pollination. And the reason why is because the pollen tube, when that gets produced from the tube cell, it's essentially carrying those two sperm and almost guiding it to the egg. So what will happen is, when that pollen grain gets dispersed in the wind, it's flying in the wind, and what it's trying to do is essentially locate the micropyle. And the micropyle is a really small opening on the surface of the ovule. So that's that female part of the cone that houses the embryo sac. So when the pollen grain lands on the micropyle, it'll get a cue. And that cue is essentially going to tell the tube cell to produce the pollen tube. And the pollen tube is going to enter the embryo sac. And when it enters the embryo sac, it's basically carrying the two sperm cells with it. And then it'll eventually burst to release the sperm. That way it'll fertilize the egg. So although it does carry two sperm cells, usually only one of them will fertilize the egg and the other one will die. So you'll typically only get one embryo. So that is the function of the pollen tube. Okay, so now we're going to go into the female strobili or the female cone. So just like the terminology with males, how it was the microsporangia that was housed on the microsporophyll, for the female, same exact thing, except you just throw the prefix mega in front of it, in which the megasporangia is housed on the megasporophyll. So if you look at this photo here on the bottom, they actually refer to the megasporophyll as the ovuliferous scale. Same exact thing. It's essentially the modified leaf or the scales of the comb. So this is one megasporophyll, also known as the ovuliferous scale, another megasporophyll, and then another megasporophyll. Again, they're basically just the scales of the comb. At the end of the megasporophyll is where you'll find individual ovules. And this is what an ovule looks like, one individual ovule will look like. Within your ovule, well, first, the outermost layer of your ovule is your integument. So the integument is basically what's protecting your megasporangia and basically also your megaspore as well, because this is where all the meiosis is going to take place. So once again, integument is your outer layer of the ovule. To the inside of your integument is your megasporangium. And again, the megasporangium is where meiosis takes place. When meiosis takes place, you have the production of your haploid megaspore. And then eventually this haploid megaspore will germinate and produce your female gametophyte, so the archegonia with the two eggs. But as of right now, since this is just a haploid megaspore, this is basically an unfertilized ovule. And then when you get the production of your egg, and then finally an embryo, that would be a fertilized ovule. So here's another picture with your megasporophyll. So that's basically, once again, the scale of the cone, and then your ovule at the very end of that megasporophyll. Here's your integument, which again, the integument is the outermost layer of that ovule. It essentially protects your megasporangium and your megaspore. And then here's that micropyle that I was talking about that the pollen grain is trying to find when it's being dispersed in the wind. So again, the micropyle is just basically that small little opening on the surface of the ovule. Here's your megasporangium to the inside of the integument, and then your one haploid megaspore. Now, in your megasporangium, you have a diploid mother cell, a diploid megaspore mother cell, that's going to undergo meiosis to produce your four haploid megaspores. Now, if you notice in this image, you only see one haploid megaspore. In the slide before that, there was also only one haploid megaspore. The reason why is because even though that megaspore mother cell produces four, typically only one of them will survive. So the other three die, one of them survives, and then the one megaspore that does survive will then germinate into your haploid megagametophyte, which is this right here, with your two eggs. So four is produced, but only one of them survives. That one that survives will germinate and produce your female gametophyte with your two eggs. So once again, once it is fertilized, you still have your integument, which is the outermost layer. Here is your micropyle. And now that this is fertilized, this the innermost region is now your megagametophyte with your archegonia. Sometimes you will still have your remnants of the megasporangium though, but the majority of it now is megagametophyte, since this is technically fertilized now. Okay, so now we're going to talk about pollination. So right here on the far left that my cursor is on, this is the microsporangium, which has individual pollen grains. So those haploid microspores have already germinated and produced your male gametophytes. Now with male cones, at least for conifers at least, they'll typically crumble apart really, really easily. And the reason why they crumble apart easily is so that they can break open and allow these pollen grains to be dispersed in the wind. Now, when it gets dispersed in the wind, remember that it wants to try and find the micropyle of the integument, so of the female ovule. Once that pollen grain lands on the micropyle of that integument, it's sitting there, and then eventually that tube cell is gonna get a cue to produce the pollen tube. That pollen tube is gonna grow down into the embryo sac, which you can see in this image over here on the right, and when it grows down, it's gonna carry those two sperm with it. But keep in mind that only one sperm will be able to fertilize the egg while the other one dies, which is why even though it produces two eggs, only one of them will become the embryo eventually. So the sperm will fertilize the egg, and then you will get your embryo, and then eventually you'll get a mature seed. Does this part make sense, the pollination part of it? Okay. Feel free to stop me at any time. But okay, so I just wanted to show you guys really quickly what a closed cone looks like and a open cone looks like. So here's a closed cone right here. If the cone is open, unfortunately, there is basically still immature seeds and they aren't able to be dispersed yet. And then when the seeds are fully ripened, then the cones will open and then they'll be able to disperse and continue to reproduce. So with mature seeds or ripened seeds, there are three different generations. You have two diploid generations and one haploid generation. One of your diploid generations is your seed coat, and this is derived from the integument of that unfertilized female ovule. So the seed coat, just like the integument, essentially acts as protection for the embryo. And because we have a seed coat, it allows the embryo to go dormant until the environmental conditions are favorable for it, basically. So again, you have your seed coat, which is the outermost region. To the inside of your seed coat is your female gametophyte, which is haploid. And your female gametophyte basically acts as the food supply for the embryo. So the embryo, this diploid embryo, is taking all of its nutrients from the female gametophyte, which is to the outside of it. This is kind of a funny looking embryo. It kind of looks like a chicken claw to me, but yeah, this is the embryo. Okay. Any questions on that before I go into the individual phyla? No? Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and go over the individual phyla now. The first one we're gonna go over is circled here in red, which is the Psychodophyta. So these were dominant during the Mesozoic, and they're also commonly referred to as the early gymnosperms because they're the more basal ones compared to the other ones that are extant today. They do have monopodial growth, meaning that they have one main trunk or one main stem that doesn't branch frequently. It does branch, just doesn't branch as often. So now we're moving into groups that display monopodial growth. There are still some that have dichotomous branching, which remember is the more basal form of branching. Dichotomous branching is what was really common in like seedless vascular plants and non-vascular plants. But now we're moving into groups that display monopodial growth. Cycads do have really woody stems with a really wide pith. So even though they do produce secondary vascular tissues, the majority of their stem is actually parenchyma because they do have a really wide pith. They are evergreen, so they have stiff pinnately compound leaves that contain tons and tons of lignin. Remember that lignin is that chemical found in the cell wall that provides a lot of rigidity and strength. And the reason why they have lignin or a lot of lignin is because they are evergreen. So they need these leaves to last a long time, and it can also help prevent cavitation as well. They do still have flagellated sperm in which their pollen is going to send out this tube that'll burst when the sperm swim down to find the egg. But they do still have that flagellated sperm, which is more of a basal characteristic. And they also are dioecious, so they're going to have separate male and female plants. So one male plant with just male cones, and then a separate female plant with just female cones. So that is dioecious. So there are four different genuses that we're going to be looking at within the Psychodophyta. We have Psychis over here on the bottom left. And then to the right of that, we have zamia, and then encephalardos, and at the very top here, we have diune. Now, I feel like, personally, cycas and zamia are the two that look the most distinct out of the four, so they're going to be the two easiest to tell apart. Cycas have really, really thin leaflets that typically will end in a spine, but the one characteristic that really defines it for me is that if you look at the individual leaflets, I know it's hard to tell in this image, but if you look at the individual leaflets of cycas, there's going to be one indentation, one vein going down the center of each leaflet, so one vascular bundle going down the middle. So that's how you can really tell the difference. Tell cycas apart from everything else. There's a lot better photos on these slides for Lab 11 that Dr. Bowich posted, but just keep that in mind that the individual leaflets of cycas only have one vascular bundle going down the center of the leaflet. And the leaves will always end in a, or the leaflets will always end in a spine. And then you have zamia. This one is my personal favorite. These guys have wider leaflets, more broad leaflets, but they are also smooth and rounded on the edges. Compared to encephalardus and diune, both of these guys will have spines on the edges of their leaflets, whereas, once again, zamia has those rounded and smooth leaf edges. If you ever get a chance to go to the Mesozoic Garden on campus near Building 3 when this quarantine is all over, we have a few different zamia plants in the Mesozoic Garden. If you touch it too, this one to me out of the four has really, really fuzzy and hairy leaflets. So that's one way that I can kind of tell them apart too. But once again, both encephalardus and diune have spines on the edges of their leaflets. They're kind of hard to tell apart, but typically encephalardus has wider leaflets and diune will have the thinner, more narrow leaflets. But yeah, again, the two that are easiest to tell apart are cycas and zamia. If the leaflets look wider and they have spines on the edges of their leaf, it's probably an encephalardus. Whereas with diune, if it has spines on the edges of their leaf, but they're a lot thinner and more narrow, it's probably diune. Okay, now as for the cones of Psychodophyta, the male cones, which is right here on the top right, these guys are woody and persistent. So these cones are typically a lot longer, in my opinion, than the female cones, and they also will not crumble apart. They're pretty woody, so they're going to last a really long time. Whereas the female cones, this is one example of a female cone of a cycad right here. They are huge, they're ginormous, but these guys are ephemeral, which means that they're eventually gonna crumble apart over time, which is what you see in this image to the right of it. But the reason why they crumble apart is so that they can disperse their really colorful seeds, which are usually gonna be found in the center of the plant. So female cone, much bigger, but they are ephemeral, so they're eventually gonna break apart to disperse their seeds, whereas the male cones are woody and persistent, so they're not gonna break apart as easily compared to the female cones. But the female cones can also exude nectar to attract certain pollinators. But speaking of pollinators, for the cycads, most of the time they are actually gonna be dispersed by vertebrate animals, which is why they are really colorful and really bright so that they can attract specific animals. Most of the time, they're actually not going to be dispersed in the wind, and the reason why is because most cycads are found in really dense vegetation, specifically in tropical forests, so animals would actually disperse their seeds a lot farther away compared to being dispersed in the wind. So again, that's why the strobili or their cones are really colorful and really bright. This picture over here on the right is actually a photo that I took of an encephalardus in the Mesozoic Garden. And these three are the female cones, these really nice female cones that have not opened yet. They have not opened yet. But if you look here where my cursor is, you can see that they're just starting to open. You can see that red seed kind of peeking through. But yeah, these are the female cones. Eventually they will break apart. Okay, so now we're going to go over the Gynkophyta. For the Gynkophyta, there is only one species left in this entire phylum. It is Ginkgo biloba, only one species. I'm sure some of you guys are familiar with Ginkgo biloba because I think people use this as a supplement for digestion. I'm not 100% sure if it's for digestion, but I know it's a supplement for something. So Gynkophyta, just like the Psychodophyta, are dioecious, so they have separate male and female plants, and they also still have flagellated sperm, so their pollen is still going to send out a tube to burst and allow the sperm to swim down to the egg. But cycads are evergreen, whereas ginkgos are deciduous. So during the winter time, they're gonna drop their leaves to prevent freeze-induced cavitation. But so ginkgos are deciduous, whereas cycads are evergreen. Okay, and so for ginkgos, they do have fan-shaped leaves that typically will have two different morphologies. They have a long shoot leaf and a short shoot leaf. And I'll show you what the long shoot and the short shoot looks like in a second. But the long shoot leaves are typically gonna have this more deeper lobing. You're usually gonna have like this almost V shape down in the center of their leaf. Whereas leaves that are found on the short shoots, they're gonna be more smooth at the top, so more entire. So short shoot leaves, smooth. Long shoot leaves are gonna have that nice, really deep lobing. So here's another picture of it right here. I like to think of the long shoot, which is this right here, as almost like the main branch or main stem. Whereas the short shoots, which this image refers to as a dwarf shoot, are almost like the lateral branches. So if you have a leaf coming off of the short shoot, those leaves are gonna be more smooth at the top. Whereas if you have a long shoot leaf, those leaves are gonna have that deeper lobing. So here's another short shoot right here with the short shoot leaves that are more smooth. And then here's your long shoot. If you had leaves coming out of that long shoot, those leaves would have the V down the center or that deep lobing. But typically the short shoots are where you're gonna find both the female and the male cones. And just like the female cones of cycads, the female cones of ginkgos can also release a droplet of nectar to attract pollinators as well. But again, they have two different leaf morphologies. Long shoot leaf, which will have that deep lobing. This is the long shoot right here. And then your short shoot leaves, also known as the dwarf shoot, will have that more smooth it'll be a more smooth leaf at the top. So the seeds of ginkgo are often called fruit because they do kind of look like a fruit, but the reason why they're thought to be a fruit is because they have a really fleshy seed coat, but they are not true fruit. We don't have the evolution of fruit until we get to angiosperms, which is next week. So they look like a fruit, but they are not a fruit. They're still part of the gymnosperms, but their seed coat is made up of three layers. Two harder layers and one fleshy outer layer. So the fleshy outer layer is why people often mistake them for fruits, but they have the same exact generations as the seed that I was telling you guys about earlier, where your seed coat is diploid, your nutritive tissue, which is your female gametophyte, is haploid, and then the embryo is diploid. So diploid seed coat, diploid embryo, haploid megagametophyte. And the megagametophyte acts as the food supply for the diploid embryo. Okay, the last phylum that we're gonna go over is the coniferophyta, which I'm sure is the one that you guys are most familiar with. So this is the largest phylum within the gymnosperms. It includes things that you guys are familiar with, like pines and redwoods, but also Podocarpus and Araucaria, which are some southern hemisphere conifers, and then the really weird but really interesting Nitali. So this is a group within the coniferophyta. Now, unlike cycads and ginkgos, conifers are monoecious, so they have the male and female cones on the same plant. And typically, for a lot of pine species at least, the male cones are usually going to be at the bottom, closer to the base of the plant, whereas the female cones are going to be up a lot higher compared to the male cones, and that's usually to prevent self-fertilization. But they are mostly monoecious within the conifers. There are some conifers like Podocarpus and Araucaria that are found in the southern hemisphere that are dioecious. The Nitales are also dioecious as well, but for the most part, the coniferophyta are monoecious. Okay, so the cones for the coniferophyta are the complete opposite of the cycadophyta. Whereas in the cycadophyta, the male cones were really, they were pretty large, they were woody and persistent, and the female cones were the ones that were ephemeral. So those are the ones that were basically gonna break apart eventually. Now this time for the conifers, the male cones, which I have over here on the left, are really, really small, and those are the ones that are gonna be ephemeral. And the reason why the male cones have to break apart so easily is because these are the guys that are gonna be dispersing the pollen in the wind. Whereas the female cones, which I have over here on the right, these are the cones that are really big. They're often lignified and they last a long time as well. And this is where the seeds are going to be found too. So here are some more examples of some male cones. I believe this is the male cone of sugar pine, also known as Pinus lambertiana. The male cones for Pinus lambertiana actually get kind of long, not that long, but long enough for a male cone, but they do still break apart pretty easily. And then I believe these two are from Pinus sylvestris. But yeah, once again, these are male cones and they are very small and they will crumble apart eventually to disperse the pollen in the wind, whereas the female cones are much, much larger. There are some female cones that can get really, really big, like this guy right here, Pinus coulteri. This is actually one of the pine species that I personally studied. They're also known as the widowmaker because these cones can get really large and heavy. And if you look closely at the scales, each of these scales actually end in like a spine that almost kind of look like a talon. But so they're called widowmakers because if they fall on your head, you're either severely injured or you just die, which is like the extreme end of it. But yeah, they're really, really heavy. And then we also have Pinus attenuata, which is the other species that I study, also known as knob cone pine, but these are the female cones. We have sugar pine again, their female cones. And then this is actually the female cones of the coast redwood, Sequoia sempervirens. But once again, female cones always gonna be larger than the male cone. Okay. So for the individual pollen grains, also known as the male gametophytes for the conifers, remember that they are going to be dispersed in the wind, so they have to be able to float on the air and travel pretty far. So the way that they do that is through these bladders that are found at the ends of the pollen grain. So this is a bladder, and then this is another bladder right here. These bladders essentially allow them to float on the air and travel a lot farther. And because they have these bladders, their sperm is not flagellated, so they do require a pollen tube to reach the egg. So when that pollen tube is produced, which you guys see on the right here, you can think of this as a mature male gametophyte. And then here on the left will be an immature male gametophyte. So remember that pollen tube will get produced from the tube cell, which is this cell right here. And that pollen tube essentially kind of finds its way, it'll basically inject itself into the embryo sac so that it can carry the two sperm with it and fertilize the egg. But remember, two sperm are produced, one will fertilize the egg, the other one will die. Okay, the last group that we're gonna be talking about is the Nitales. This is a group found within the conifers. Some early evolutionary forms of the Nitales were lianas or vines, so they had really narrow stems and reduced leaves, but they are very, very morphologically diverse. Not only are there vines, but there are trees, shrubs, bunch of different morphologies within the Nitales, and their male strobili actually really do look like flowers because they protrude out of the microsporophylls and they kind of cluster together like an inflorescence of a flower. So their male strobili resemble flowers, but other characteristics that actually actually caused people to think that the Nitales were the closest sister lineage to the angiosperms is because one, they had double fertilization. So it results in the production of two embryos. So basically both the sperms fertilize both the eggs. Even though one of the embryo dies, both eggs still get fertilized, which is a characteristic found in angiosperms. But not only that, they also had vessels on top of tracheids for water transport. So with gymnosperms, which with most conifers, cycads, and ginkgos, they only have tracheids for water transport. But because the Nitales have vessels, that is why they were thought to be the closest lineage to angiosperms. But it turns out, based on their DNA, they're actually a group nestled within the conifers. So with these two characteristics, double fertilization and vessels, because they're not closely related to the angiosperms, these characteristics actually evolved as a result of convergent evolution, meaning that they have the same characteristics that have the same function, but not the same common ancestor. Okay, so a few of the species that we're going to be looking at within the Nitales in this lab is Welwitschia. This one is really cool. This is a plant native to the Namibian desert in Africa, and throughout its entire lifetime, it only produces two leaves from the base. And what's even crazier is that their basal meristem has wood in it, which is weird. Meristems don't typically produce wood. And then we also have ephedra. These guys have really obvious vessels. Every member in the Nitales have vessels, but it just looks particularly nice in ephedra. So you guys are going to be able to look at some cross sections of ephedra wood in this lab. They have much smaller cones compared to Welwitschia, and the female cones will typically only develop one seed. And then finally, we have Needham. These guys have broad leaves that are typically pinnately compound. And these guys really do look like an angiosperm and not a conifer at all. And especially because a lot of conifers have those needle-like leaves, whereas Needham, they just look like regular angiosperm leaves. But here is Welwitschia mirabilis. Once again, they only produce two leaves during its entire lifetime. So this is one leaf right here, and then this is another leaf. It's pretty crazy. Even though it might look like multiple leaves, it just looks like that because it's starting to form tears as it grows older and more mature, but in reality, it's really only two leaves. And this is its basal meristem right here with some of the cones coming out. Over here to the right, we have ephedra nevadensis. This kind of reminds me of the horsetails, but the wood of ephedra is super cool, so you guys are going to be able to look at that in the slides PowerPoint. And then we have Needham over here, which is more of a tree. And then these are the cones, but even though they look like fruit, they are indeed cones. They just have that fleshy seed coat surrounding their individual seeds. Okay. So that was it for my PowerPoint. Does anybody have any questions or want me to go over anything again?
I was wondering for the conifers, mm-hmm. when the female, doesn't the female megaspore, mm-hmm. doesn't it open twice, like once to be pollinated and then once to spread the seed? Or
from what I know, they typically will only open once just to spread the seeds. It depends. So one way that they can open is just by really falling on the ground and dispersing their seeds that way through animals or whatever. But sometimes once the ovule is completely fertilized, then it's almost like a cue and they'll start to open their scales kind of slowly.
Okay.
There are some cones, like one of the trees that I study, Pinus tenuata, which is, I'll show you this picture. It's the knobcone pine right here. So this cone right here on the bottom left, these guys are one of the three closed cone pines in California that are native to California. And they'll only open in response to fire or some really, really hot temperature. So they're essentially closed until they're exposed to that really extreme temperature. Pretty crazy. Any other questions? Okay, so just so you guys know, this, I'm pretty sure Lauren had already posted this PowerPoint to your Blackboard site, so you guys do have access to it. And I